We'll call the meeting of Door County Board of Supervisors for Tuesday, July 25th, right?
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Okay, roll call. What'd you do?
We're trying to keep up.
I don't know. I'm assuming something of these.
Oh, God. It could be worse.
Plenty of room.
Just finish and then I'll call.
Well, we'll call a roll call.
Manually.
I can call it.
Yeah, call it.
If all else fails.
Let me call it.
She was so happy just minutes ago.
I'll call a roll call. Busted is here. Brent, Brown?
Here.
Burr?
Here.
Engelbert?
Here.
Antigo?
Here.
Fisher?
Here.
Gunnlaugson?
Present.
Haynes?
Here.
Halsted?
Here.
Cook?
Here.
Cohout?
Here.
Cock?
Here.
Leno?
Here.
Miller?
Here.
Ninus?
Here.
Schultz?
Here.
City?
Present.
Burley?
Here.
Zipper?
Here, how come I'm always last?
Beats me. So there's 19 present and 2 seats vacant. And just a note on that, the vacancies, applications have to be in by the 4 o'clock on this Friday. And so far, we only have one applicant that would be in Ben Myers District, none from the Gibraltar area. I forget what the number is up there, so. And?
I'm still having anything because we're not available for it unless we have it. Even if they can't see what they're doing.
Oh, I called the roll call.
I know, but in order for us to move forward on this for our 2/3 vote.
Oh, okay.
We still need them to get there.
But we can still go through some of this stuff now, can we?
Yes, but if we did it right now.
So what do you want us to do, wait?
Austin has taken Jill's job.
Oh, hit that you're here. It shows up on this screen. So she can move on.
I did vote for him.
Hopefully it worked.
Chuck? You want to hit there?
You won't see it, but for us to move on.
Ninus, John, where are you? And Biz?
This should come from.
It's highly complicated.
She can see, but we can't.
Yeah.
She has special vision.
Leno?
Leno and.
Zipper, you got to.
Just confirm.
Just confirm. Here comes.
Thank you.
Should we wait for him now? Okay. Are you ready to take notes in?
I'm fine, yeah.
Okay, a motion of the presentation of the agenda.
So moved.
Second.
Motion by Mark Miller, seconded by Kathy Schultz. All in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? That has passed. We have special report, Public Health. Mary Ellen Smith, Rhonda, you coming forward with Kathy to give the award and tell us what it's all about? And Mary Ellen too, of course. Kathy, you going there with them or not?
No, I don't need to.
Okay.
I want to take her thunder away.
Good morning. I was going to keep this short, but then I thought, no, I'm just going to tell you everything.
We have time.
Thank you for the opportunity to come and recognize Mary Ellen Smith for the award that she received. Mary Ellen is an RN, public health nurse, with the Door County Public Health Department, and she has received the Distinguished Service in Public Health Nursing Cornelia Van Coy Award. And this was given by the Wisconsin Public Health Association, Public Health Nursing Section, and it's the 11th Annual Public Health Nursing Awards. And she received it August 5th in Stevens Point. The purpose of this award was to recognize Mary Ellen's contributions to public health nursing practice with interagency, community, region, state, nation, or globally by demonstrating outstanding public health nursing performance or other accomplishments relating to population health. There's only one recipient of this award per year in Wisconsin, so Mary Ellen won that award for the state. Cornelia Van Coy is known as the matriarch of public health nursing in Wisconsin. In 1911, when Cornelia Van Coy joined the staff of the Milwaukee Health Department as its first child welfare nurse, the country was in the throes of a tuberculosis epidemic. She was a pioneer in public health, first as a developer of educational programs and later as a mobilizer of public support on various levels. During her career, she served on the State Board of Health and the Wisconsin Nurses Association and provided the training to public health nurses statewide. Van Coy expanded the state's public health nursing service model from individual care of the sick to a broader health service for the entire community. It's interesting to note that I looked Cornelia Van Coy up in the Advocate archives and actually found her listed in the Door County Democrat, July 14, 1916. Mm-hmm. And interestingly enough, she was the first visiting nurse hired in Door County. So it was quite a coincidence. Miss Van Coy of Milwaukee is engaged by school board and women's club. At that time, Sturgeon Bay City hired this visiting nurse, and a lot of it had to do with a women's club who actually was the one who went out and tried to get a nurse for the city. Miss Van Coy of Milwaukee will arrive here on October 1st and take up her duties. It was the wish of the board and women's club to have Miss Coy at the opening of the school term, but she had a previous engagement. Miss Coy's engagement by the board and club is of a temporary nature, but is desired to make it permanent. It is hoped that her serving will be so satisfactory as to warrant the school board reinstating her. Miss Coy will supervise the health of the children attending school and will look after their physical welfare in every respect. Nearly every large city in the country, and now many of the smaller towns, are realizing the benefits of a visiting nurse. In many cities, the city council provides the visiting nurse or nurses, depending upon the size of the city. On Wednesday night, July 19th, the Women's Club has arranged a program at the Crystal Theater, Mr. Stock having donated the use of the theater, the proceeds of which will be devoted to helping the school board pay for the services of nurse. A bachelor's romance will be shown in pictures, and there will be special singing and dancing. And then throughout some of the archives, she's mentioned a lot. She did a lot of speaking in different communities. So it was interesting that she was the first one. And then when it went to a county nurse, that was in 1935. And that was the first time that the county had a county nurse. And that was, what was her name?
We know it.
Yeah. Bry?
Ruth Bry.
Ruth Bry.
Ruth Bry.
Yes, Ruth Bry was hired then.
Dan was here.
She gave Dan was on the original interview.
You were, Kathy. You were too.
Was I really?
Yeah.
I was going to ask if anyone remembered Ms. Van Coy. So now I'm going to read a little bit about Mary Ellen and why I nominated her for this award. Mary Ellen Smith began her public health nursing career in the 1980s. After starting in the Door County Public Health Department, she left for a few years to work as a home care nurse. Public health nursing and home care were combined in the Door County Public Health Department at that time. The home health care part split off from the health department, and the staff were also split between the two agencies. If you remember, Porter Keno home care used to be a county service, and then they split off. So some of the staff went with Porter Keno Home Care and some stayed in the Public Health Department. The director of the Health Department at that time left and started a home care business with the home health part from the Health Department. And then Mary Ellen came back to the Health Department in March of 1988 and has been a public health nurse since. Mary Ellen has had a remarkable career as a public health nurse for Door County. She exemplifies all the best qualities of a public health nurse. I've been fortunate to work with Mary Ellen since 1991 when I started working at the Door County Public Health Department as the director. It is difficult to write about everything that Mary Ellen has done for public health in Door County because the list is so long. I will start with some of the major population health initiatives that she has worked tirelessly to implement. In 1999, Mary Ellen was one of the original founding members of a group of community members who met in a local coffee shop in the evening consistently every 2 weeks for 6 months to organize a new free sliding fee scale primary care clinic for individuals. That original creation has since given birth to the free dental clinic, the Hispanic Resource Center of Door and Kewaunee Counties, and the Community Clinic of Door County. Mary Ellen played a significant contributing role to the creation of this clinic, which continues to operate today as the Community Clinic of Door County. We met down at the, if you remember, the Fairfield had a coffee shop sort of in the basement there. And that's where we met to develop that clinic. Mary Ellen also worked with a community group to establish the Ministry Door County Medical Center Dental Clinic, which is a nonprofit facility that provides oral health care to the youth and adults of Door and Kewaunee counties. The clinic has served those who are on Medicaid and or those with no dental insurance that are low income and with no dental home since 1999. In total, more than 2,800 individuals in need were served by the dental clinic in 2013. Mary Ellen has worked with our Women, Infants, and Children program and our Prenatal Care Coordination program to encourage and support breastfeeding mothers. She's been instrumental in developing a breastfeeding work group for local health care providers to share information and resources to try and encourage breastfeeding families. She has also been an active participant in the organization of a breastfeeding support group for Door County families. Currently, Mary Ellen has incorporated the life course framework for maternal child health programs in her practice and is one of the several founding members of a new initiative in Door County called the Door County Partnership for Children and Families. Mary Ellen and one of the principals from one of our school districts met and discussed the need for children to be ready for school. School staff had seen many children coming into the school system who had very low school readiness skills. In order to try and intervene in this community problem, they held a meeting called a community discussion about Door County children and families. It was set up similar to a World Cafe format, and different topics were discussed at different tables with moderators and note takers. The participation from the community was huge. There were about 90 people at this first meeting. Of these, 45 people wanted to be actively engaged in this initiative going forward. Another meeting was held and approximately 50 people attended. Work groups were set up for various topics and these meetings were held and again well attended. Mary Ellen is a member of the Wisconsin Maternal Mortality Review Team, which is a state team. She's one of the only public health nurses on that team. And they look at maternal mortality and trying to identify reasons why pregnant women would have died regarding that. So she's been in that group since 2001, since the inception. She is also on the regional child death review team for Northeastern Wisconsin. And that again is looking at the deaths of children to see if we can impact that through prevention or changing policies. Recently, Mary Ellen completed the Grapevine nurse training from the Wisconsin Women's Health Foundation so that she can provide free health education sessions to women in our community. She is planning educational presentations for Door County. She's also a trained first breath provider to help Wisconsin women quit or reduce smoking during pregnancy and beyond. Mary Ellen is also a contributing member to another new initiative in the community called Cradle to Career. This group has also been very active and has received grant dollars to hire a part-time coordinator. This group will address young families and their needs. These are just a few of the programs that Mary Ellen has initiated and participated in. Mary Ellen truly cares for the people in the community and has had the drive and zeal to really make a difference for the people in Door County. For those reasons, I nominated her for the award. And she was chosen for the award. And now I'm going to let Mary Ellen say a few things.
Thank you, Rhonda.
Well, I'd like to give a special thank you to Kathy Schultz, who is the chair of the Board of Health, for inviting Rhonda and I here today. We appreciate it, Kathy. On July 13th, I returned from vacation and was looking at my emails. And as we all know, when we've been gone, we have lots of emails to go through, and I do not look at my emails when I'm on vacation. I'm not one of those people. So as I was going through all those emails, I came across one that said, "Congratulations, you have won the Distinguished Service in Public Health Nursing Award." The email came from someone I didn't know and from a website I didn't recognize. So I really didn't pay a lot of attention to it on that sweep through all those emails. But I went back a couple times, and the third time I looked at it, I did print it because I thought, well, what is this? So I printed it and realized it must be true. Rhonda was off that day, so I couldn't talk to her, so I did text Rhonda. Rhonda called me back and said yes, she had nominated me for this award. I was absolutely astounded and so honored, I couldn't believe it. When I think of all the wonderful public health nurses that I work with and that I know throughout the state, I feel this is really a tremendous honor. I didn't tell anybody except my husband because I still really didn't believe it. The next day, Rhonda called the whole staff together, and very surprisingly, everyone was in the office, which is a rare occurrence in our office. On top of that, no one was on the phone, nobody was on a home visit, nobody was at a meeting, nobody had an appointment in the office at that moment. So she called everybody together, and she read what she had written, what she read today, and I was again really astounded and really honored, speechless almost. But however, on that day, on every day since, I have said the same thing. Although I may have gotten this award, I truly believe it is an award for the entire Door County Public Health Department. I would not have been able to do a lot of the things I have done. It's a group effort. It's all of us working together. So I really believe, and if you look at my award right on the bottom, it does say Door County Public Health Department. I really believe it is an award for all of us. I work with such a great group, my current coworkers, my past coworkers. We're a great bunch and really have always worked really well together. I've also worked with so many other people from the county, different county departments, and of course many, many community members, some of you who are sitting right here, I've worked with committees on. So I've worked with a lot of people. And that is part of the other reason why I did receive this award. Rhonda Kohlberg's leadership, vision, and full understanding of public health nursing and the services that we provide is the other reason that I received this award today. Rhonda is a wonderful leader. Really helps keep us on track when maybe we have some crazy idea. She's very tactfully says, well, maybe we don't want to do that. But I really want to thank Rhonda for all of her leadership and guidance. I wouldn't have gotten the award without that. At the Wisconsin Public Health Nurse Conference, where I received the award, our keynote speaker encouraged us to market our services better than we do. It's been the focus of about 2 years worth of meetings we go to that they keep telling us we don't tell anybody what we do, and that's we should be. Our priority has always been to go about our work serving the people of Door County. That's what we think about. But we have learned we also need to let the community know more about what we do. Winning this award has given the entire health department many more opportunities to talk to people about what we do. And I really appreciate the opportunity to come and talk to you today. And I want you all to remember, public health is leading efforts to protect and promote the health of our entire community. Thank you very much. And here's the award.
Thank you very much.
You're welcome.
Next on the agenda, by the way, the years of service recognition for Dennis Andrews, he could not make it today. That's why we bypassed it. That's correct, Reg, just couldn't make it. Okay?
What, Kaloji couldn't give him a day off, or what?
Yep, I think he's retired.
He already quit in August.
In under correspondence, the unassigned fund belt is in your packet. The Wisconsin Historical Society notice of entry in a state register, Jacksonport Wharf Archaeology District. Anybody got any questions on those? If not, we'll go to public comment. Does anybody in the public want to make a comment? There being none, we'll skip the, go ahead, Leo.
I don't know where this might fit, but we all come through the entrance to the government center off of the library side, and I think it should be noted, and I believe it's Sue Leroy that takes care of the flower beds, and she's really done an outstanding job, and we walk past it every time and look at it, and we never give her any credit for the good job that she had done.
Okay. Very good.
So I give her an attagirl.
Attagirl, okay. Administrator's monthly report. Here's your first chance.
There we go. Now, I'll keep it short. I guess this is one thing I did provide it in last week's memo to you all, but just an update on the budget. Right now, it looks like we are on target, just in terms of the timeline. Obviously, we've been coming on board. I was a little concerned on making sure to digest everything, but both with help Mark and also Shirley, we are on target. All the department head meetings are complete. So now we are moving forward with both analyzing, I guess, the request for either position changes or new positions. And then the other part of the equation also, too, is the our pay-for-performance program, or our pay plan, and how that's going to be rolled out into the budget. So I'm hoping, and everything's going well, that everything's going to roll into our budget adoption process, but everything is on target as of today. So that's all I have for report.
Okay. Anybody have any questions? If not, a motion to approve the minutes. Moved by Chuck Brand, seconded by Don City. Are there any corrections or additions? All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? That is passed. Okay, on the next two resolutions, I'm going to make a couple comments here. The one on the Human Services Center and also the ambulance garage. We had a conversation, I had a conversation with Biz Verley, and he's the chairman of the property committee temporarily, at least, because he was vice chairman and Ben was chairman, so Biz is taking over that job right now. Apparently, the lease with the hospital has still not been settled, and there's more members of the county board telling me that they would like to see the property purchased instead of rented. Dan Williams has stated to me, and Dan's back there, you can correct me if I'm wrong, that the operation at the present ambulance garage is working. Not the best, but it is working, and we have 15 years left on the lease, I think it is. The Senior Citizen Center, with the addition of the trailer, is working. There again, not the best, but it's working. One of the things that have come up is the possibility of $1 million runoff plan for the senior citizens. We put it where we're talking about. The $1 million, as to my knowledge, has still not arrived. The one that put us on a fast track, we were told, is out there, and it still hasn't been solidified that it's there. Coupled with that, we got to do something with the old highway shop. Right now, the two projects are projected at $9 million. They're going to look into that. What could, and Biz has called a special meeting of the property committee at 8:30 Thursday.
That's correct.
To basically go over these bullet points and more and talk about those two properties. We have a lot of we have time to look this over and thoroughly make a decision. So my recommendation today is to make a motion to postpone those two resolutions to the next county board meeting. And I've been told by Grant that we can discuss, when we do make the motion of postponing it to the next county board, we can discuss it afterwards. So
I'll second that.
Who made the motion?
Oh, I'll make the motion. You were going to make.
Okay, motion by Ken, seconded by.
I'll second.
Chuck, no, Chuck seconded. Now, is there any discussion? Is anybody, go ahead, Susan.
I just wonder why we have to do anything with the motions. I mean, it is in the property committee's ballpark at this point to implement them. So I'm not sure why we have to do anything as a county board until they're ready to come back to us.
Well, the resolution on the floor right now, and correct me if I'm wrong, Grant, gives the ambulance, the health, not the ambulance, emergency service committee to proceed forward and spend a little bit of money for plans that may not be the plans of the building we're going to want. Am I correct on that, John? Grant?
It's actually contingent upon us either securing the site by lease or purchase of the property. To answer Susan's question, the property committee did refer both of these matters back to the county board because I think it was anticipated that the fundraising goal would not be achieved with the Human Resources Center, and also because of the issue with the lease not being fully resolved yet.
Are there any other questions? Go ahead, David.
So, Grant, if the issue is the September 1 funding mechanism for the donation that was expected, what happens to the resolution after the 1st of September?
Ultimately, that will fall to the county board to decide, because if that date comes and goes and the funding goal is not achieved, then that would prohibit proceeding with phase 3 of the project because the condition precedent was not met. Now, I think common sense says is if the fundraising condition was subsequently met, then phase 3 could proceed. Again, ultimately, it's going to come down to the county board to decide what to do if the condition precedent isn't timely met.
Okay. I think, David, your committee, the finance committee, talked about whether the Friends of the Senior Citizen wanted to be fundraisers or not fundraisers, and that was going to be an issue that you're going to bring forward to your committee and talk to them?
We haven't really had that discussion.
I know that, but it's going to be on your agenda to talk to the fundraising committee, whether they're going to participate, want to participate, or not for this project. And you're going to bring, I think it's Dale Wiegand and a few people to your committee to talk about it.
Yes.
Are there any other questions? Susan?
Okay, so Grant said that the property committee referred these two matters back to us. But what are we supposed to do with them, considering the fact that neither contingency in either resolution has been met at this point? So what are we supposed to do?
Well, with the Central Ambulance Station project, there's not a time constraint. I anticipate that we will have a meeting of the minds with respect to the lease of the property for the ambulance station. And at this point, the ball is in our court to revise the site plan in accordance with the request from the hospital, and also to go back through the hospital's outside counsel attorney, Jim Smith, with alternative language to the lease that was proposed. And I would anticipate that that process will be done in time for the September County Board meeting. But with the with the fundraising goal not being met by the time indicated in the resolution, again, I'm repeating myself, ultimately it'll be left to the county board to decide what to do. But what I can say is that phase 3 will not proceed at this point.
Right.
Okay, are there any other questions? David?
So as far as the property committee special meeting that they're having, the purpose of that is we're referring it back to both of these back to them. Okay, for their input and decision to do something different, continue along the path, or all of the above.
Correct. Okay. It's sort of an open discussion on what to do with the two building projects. Any other questions?
Dan, is the county board going to have a chance to express their opinion whether to put this EMS building on leased or purchased property before? So there's a little direction for the committees?
I guess that'd be up for the property. I don't know the answer to that question, really. It's going to be up to the property committee what they come up with. I know there is some people on the county board that adamantly say we should not rent. And there's some people that say the hospital lease is great. And we're going to hope that the property committee, which has six members, can straighten it out and come with a recommendation to county board grant.
And we should note in resolution number 2015-59 that it does give the property committee the discretion to approve the county's acquisition of the selected site by long-term lease or purchase. It doesn't express a preference for either, but it's also important to note that as of today's date and today's time, the hospital has expressed zero interest in selling the property.
Correct. Did that answer your question? We do have a chance that the lease has to come before the county board, and we have a chance then to kill it or...
Well, I was curious if they would have the direction to whether they should just reload on this subject and go look for a piece of property or continue on with a leased property.
I think that's the idea of the property committee. When Biz and I talked, that we would reload would be a good, I say, just step back and take a deep breath and reevaluate all our positions.
Yeah, because the recommendation of the property committee is advisory to this board ultimately.
Right.
For us to come get a kick at it again, you know.
Reload would be a good answer.
Yeah.
Just to double check. I think it would be a shame that, and in the property committee packet is an artist's rendition of the highway shop remodeled or for Efren, if you guys, I don't know who was all here with Efren. They proposed to buy the county highway shop and had an artist's rendition. When you see that, and I'm sure you're going to see it, it might have second thoughts on what to do with that. Biz is well aware that in the discussion of the ambulance garage and the senior citizen center, the third factor you're going to discuss is the, what we're going to do with the highway garage, whether we use it for parks and airport, whether we tear it down, whether we convert it into something, and that's going to be part of your discussion, right, Biz?
That's correct.
So basically stepping back, taking a good look, reload is a good answer, good way. Any other questions? If not, we'll, David.
And just a clarification, resolution 2015-52, the Human Services Resource Center project. September 2nd comes around, that resolution is dead, correct? We've danced around that statement, but that resolution is dead if there's no funding.
Well, the authorization to proceed with phase three disappears.
That resolution dies.
Yeah, I guess you're correct, yeah.
I don't know if I'd say the resolution dies. I think we actually want the resolution to remain in effect, but the impact of not having the funding in hand by September 1st is there is no longer authority to proceed with phase three, and it would have to come back to this body for further direction.
It says to proceed contingent upon.
Right.
So why would the resolution still exist?
So the resolution's a pronouncement of the county board, and with the resolution... says is that the property committee or the county is authorized to proceed with phase three if $1 million in donation gifts or grants for the project are received on or before September 1. If that comes and goes, then the authorization to proceed with phase three no longer exists, and it would be back in the hands of the county board as to whether or not the project would move forward or as it has been contemplated die on the vine. We're saying the same thing, David, I think.
Are there any other questions?
In a lawyer-ese way, yes.
And he's winning.
Okay, go to your voter board and vote the postponement of these two items, okay. Both of them postponed to the next county board meeting.
Oh, it works.
Hey.
Going.
Yeah, it's working. That is passed on a vote of 19 yes, 2 vacant. Next item is the resolution in recognition and appreciation of distinguished service of Grant Thomas. I guess, who'd like to read that? I guess I'll have to read it. Whereas by adoption of resolution 2014-88, Grant Thomas Corporation Counsel was appointed to the service as interim county administrator, convincing November 4th, 2014. Whereas in addition to continuing to serve as corporate counsel, Grant Thomas agreed to serve as interim county administrator for no additional compensation, began serving as interim county administrator on November 4th, 2014, and will continue to serve through August 2nd, 2015. And whereas during said nine-month period, Grant selfishly devoted countless hours of time at work and at home, both during the week and on weekends, diligently ensuing that the day-by-day functions of the county administrative office would continue uninterrupted, while at the same time providing his usual commitment to excellence as corporation counsel. Now, therefore, be resolved that the Door County Board has assembled at this 25th day of August, 2015. Wholeheartedly extend to Grant Thomas our sincere thanks and appreciation of his dedication, devotion, and exemplary service during his dual role as corporation counsel and interim administrator. Do I have a motion and a second?
I'll make that motion, Mr. Chairman.
Motion by Fisher.
Fisher.
Seconded by Susie. Go ahead. All in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Round of applause.
You caught me by surprise at the last meeting, and well, you didn't, but I got my bottle of scotch. First of all, I want to express my appreciation to each and every member of the board, because without the trust you placed in me, without the freedom you gave me to perform the two jobs, and without the assistance I was given, I would have never been able to do this now for the second time. And secondly, I would be remiss, and I mentioned this at the department head meeting, there's only a few back there, the county is blessed with 30-some talented and dedicated department heads who pretty much do their jobs without too much guidance. And without their efforts, without their assistance, there's just no way in heck that one person can keep the ship that is Door County afloat and pointed in the right direction for 6 months. So really, this is a recognition. The fact that we can exist with an interim county administrator for 6 months is a statement to the fact that we have wonderful department heads who do their jobs and go above and beyond the call of duty. So thank you, and I appreciate the gift of scotch that was given last time.
Okay. Thank you again, Grant. Recognizing Supervisor Holly Rehnquist for serving in Door County. Kathy, would you like to read the resolution?
Sure. Whereas Elizabeth Holly Rehnquist was appointed to the Door County Board of Supervisors in October 2010. She was duly elected in April 2012 and re-elected in April 2014. And whereas Supervisor Rehnquist represented Supervisory District 18, encompassing the town of Gibraltar and the village of Ephraim. And whereas during her tenure, Supervisor Rehnquist served on the Board of Health, Community Programs Board, and Human Services Board. Now, therefore, be resolved that the County Board of Supervisors, assembled this 25th day of August 2015, extends to Elizabeth Holly Rehnquist our sincere thanks and appreciation for her service to the people of Door County, and wish her the best in her future endeavors. And I'll make the motion.
Okay, is there a second?
I'll second.
Seconded by David. All in favor, say aye.
Aye. Aye.
Opposed? That is passed. Would someone like to read the resolution for Ben Meyer? Susan?
Sure.
Go ahead.
Whereas Ben Meyer was duly elected to the Door County Board of Supervisors in April 2008, he was re-elected in April 2010, 2012, 2014, and whereas Supervisor Meyer represented Supervisory District 7, encompassing the city of Sturgeon Bay, Wards 1, 2, and 29, and whereas Supervisor Meyer served on several committees and boards, including Airport and Parks, Board of Health, Community Programs, Information Systems, Land Conservation, Legislative, Library, Museum Archives, Risk Management and Insurance, Social Services, and Ad Hoc Jindachin Sister City Advisory Group, and whereas Supervisor Meyer also served as Chairman of Property Committee and the Long-Term Support Planning Committee. Now, therefore, be it resolved that the County Board of Supervisors, assembled this 25th day of August, 2015, extends to Ben Meyer our
sincere thanks and appreciation for his service to the people of Door County and wish him the best in his future endeavors.
Can I make
that motion?
Is there a second?
Second.
Seconded by Paul. All in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? That has passed. Next item is the resolution for the continuation of the sister city relation with Jinjiang, China. Someone will make a motion, put this on the floor, and then we'll discuss it. Chuck,
I'll make that motion.
Chuck made the motion. Susan seconded, oh, Roy, I, Roy seconded. What this is, a continue, and also put $5,000 in the budget to continue this relationship. Does anybody want to speak on the reason that this is a positive step, or, like, Susan, I guess you're the one that might know the most about it by anybody.
Well, I will say some things, but I think you have at least one.
Oh, yeah, I see Bill Schuwar back there.
So you have Bill Schuwar and Bill Schuster as well.
They don't know it yet, but come on up, Bill.
But what I would say is, I think since you appointed that ad hoc committee, the committee, and particularly the two bills, spent a lot of time trying to turn this into a community project and not just a Door County project. And I think seeds have been planted and projects started towards that direction. I believe it needs to continue in that direction, but we're not there yet.
Okay. Go ahead, Bill.
Well, when Dan had asked the two of us to take on the sister city relationship, there was a number of tasks we were supposed to do. One was to strengthen the relationship, and two was to work on the next delegation to go, and then three was to report back to Dan and the county board on our thoughts on the continuation of sister city. And before we put in the effort that we've put in, it really wasn't being developed into this community-based program, and you've heard me say that before, and I think Susie just said something similar. After a significant amount of effort by a group of people, and then the efforts of people who have returned from Jinjiang, we went back to the ad hoc committee, which has three county board members on it now, Ben Meyer used to be on, and also a number of private citizens who have interest, and a motion was made to forward this resolution. It went to the Joint Finance and Administrative Committee agenda, and we presented our thoughts at that time. We believe, and Bill can hop in here because he put together the list, we believe there's been some significant accomplishments and that it has made a big step towards that community-based. And we'll be frank with you is that I think we were not in favor of continuing if we couldn't start to grow this community-based effort. It has to have its core in this building, but it's got to be a community base with all the various faces and trades of Door County. I think that's really important. I don't know, Bill, you want to mention some of the ongoing projects?
Sure. Again, very briefly, some of the initiatives that are seeming to be picking up some momentum are the construction of a Door County Square in our sister city. Again, we had volunteers come up with a design that reflects our culture and our history here in Door County. That is under discussion for construction. We have had an exchange of medical personnel, our folks visiting their hospitals and medical facilities, their folks visiting ours. And there's discussion again about future cooperation and collaboration and learning from each other in the medical industry. There's some seeds about doing selling of Door County products in adjacent to the Door County Square in this redevelopment district in our sister city. There's interest in the arts. We have a standing offer from our sister city to send any Door County resident for a 3-week scholarship, all expenses paid, room and board, as well as tuition for attending a 3-week course in ceramics in our sister city. And there's again some, you know, continued discussion between artists here and there about future exchanges. Did I miss anything?
No, and thank you. The other item is, and it will come up as it always does, is the cost of it. The delegations that go to China, that's all at private expense. So there's been a significant donation of money to work on this effort. The hosting, and when we have people come and visit,
As long as the county's had the sister city relationship, there's been some county expenditures in the hosting activities. We hosted them this year, and we went to the finance committee and administrative committee, I think, and got some direction as to whether we should go ahead and expend some money in the hosting. And to be upfront, we spent about $3,500. Most of that was housing. About half it was housing. And even at that, if we talk about the community base, Stone Harbor gave us an excellent discounted rate. We tried to put a value to all the other efforts that were put into the program and not people's time, just donated food, donated gifts, people put money into providing gifts. Just that came up to about $2,600. There'd be substantially more if I put a value into the in-kind cost of all the private citizens that put time in. But when people say there's no money being expended, I cringe a little bit because everything does cost, and we want to be upfront. We asked the administrative finance committee to support a budget line of $5,000. There already has been a $2,500 in a intergovernment agreement sort of, I don't know what exactly it's phrased, but it's $2,500. It was Ken's recommendation, because they are working through the budget, to modify that resolution to say up to $5,000 as they work through the budget. So that's where we're at. Our recommendation, and the recommendation from most of the administrative and finance committee, is to proceed with continuing the relationship. Bill and I have been working on looking at reaching out for people who are interested in going in October. You may have seen that in the paper. It may seem premature because we aren't here, but just based on time, we had to proceed with casting out that net. We have a meeting tomorrow and next week. We meet with these individuals to explain what the process is. We've got it's a small group so far that's shown interest, but it's from the medical industry, from private business, from local government, but those kind of behinds. And so we've got that interest building.
Okay, is there any questions? Don?
Yes, is this a one-time expense of $5,000 for 2016 budget, or is this going to be a continuation for 17, 18, 19?
It's a request for the 2016 budget. I would be disingenuous if I said we weren't going in the future hope to have financial support from the county, but this is a one-year request. We've been talking about this community-based program and doing fundraising. So while I can't make any commitment to what 2017 is going to be, we have discussed efforts of raising money. We did get money from others already. I think as we go forward, we have to see it. But this is a one-year request. But I'm not giving you a commitment that we won't ask for money, and it's because you'll remember I said it.
Is there any other questions? Paul.
Do we have any other relationship with, say, other national cities, other U.S. cities that have relationships with Chinese cities?
I don't think so.
No, we don't. We don't. But interesting enough, and I think this fits into the future, Chicago has a sister city relationship with two cities, Shanghai, and I forget the other one. And in about a month, they're having a sister city conference of how to have sister city relationships within China and build business. As we've mm-hmm. talked to the Chinese, they think one of the big impacts on Door County eventually is going to be the tourism impact. And by the way, the delegation spent far more money here than what we spent on them. So we put the money back in the economy. But the concept that we are close to Chicago, where people can fly in, and close to a Chinese sister city, Door County is a nice one-day, two-day trip. So that's their perspective. They talk a lot about they have a class of folks that are beginning to have begun to travel all over the world, and they're well-moneyed.
You know. Susan.
One other thing that we talked about at our committee meeting is we were given two leads of contacts of people in Wisconsin in communities that have sister city mm-hmm. relationships True. With other Chinese cities.
So one of the things we talked about is contacting them and finding out, how does their model work? How do they handle their sister city with a Chinese city?
You know, it's a challenge when you're trying to work out, making sure everyone understands back and forth between two very different cultures, different language. It isn't, you know, it isn't just slam dunk and you understand what's going on, and vice versa. You know, they misinterpret what we mean. So at each step, and I think that'd be helpful, not only the two that you're talking about, but even just how the Chicago representatives work with business opportunities. Because as Bill knows better than I do, the challenges of international business, you know, that's out of my league.
Any other questions? Go ahead.
As a taxpayer, and I asked you, what bang for the buck am I getting as a taxpayer?
Right.
And you have measurable results.
I don't have measurable results. I can, and someone at our meeting said we're planting seeds, but I would say they spent more money in Door County than we spent on them. They spent a lot more money in Wisconsin than we spent on them. I think the opportunity for more measurable is in the future. We are, Bill and I were just talking, we're working on some correspondence on that a local retailer is communicating back and forth with a gentleman. His name is Jan June. He got his master's in Milwaukee. And this person would become a provider of products. But I can't give you a measurable, you know, at this moment. Is there value in it? I think there's some intrinsic value to all of it. But I would repeat again, these folks spent a lot of money in Door County. They left with boxes, so a lot more than $3,500.
Any other questions? Ken?
Yeah, I voted no to this when I came to the Joint Finance Admin meeting. I understand, and I do see some potential benefit to this situation in the future, but I'm not going to support it. You say they brought more money in. We paid $3,500 at one half of 1% that we get from tax. How much would they have to spend for us to get the $3,500? I don't think they did that. It may come to that, but we were told when this started, this was not going to cost. It was for the pottery situation, and we were told this is not going to cost the county penny one. And you know, we've got, whether you want to admit or not, we've got staff that's paid by the county that's using their time to promote this. That's a cost. And like I say, I understand there could be some potential benefits to this, but we were told, nope, it wasn't going to cost a dollar, and now we're asking to double what we did last year. It's just going to grow. And you know, whether you want to admit it or not, the more the government steps in to fund something, the less volunteerism helps out. And so I'm just going to vote no to it. I'm sorry.
Anybody else? John?
I guess I want to kind of mirror the feelings of Mr. Fisher. I have a concern here. I have in front of me the resolution 2004-41. That's the resolution that started that. Fiscal impact. There is no fiscal impact with the adoption of this resolution. Let me repeat that. There is no fiscal impact with the adoption of this resolution. Now, if we want to start adopting resolutions where there's no fiscal impact, and after a while down the line say, nah, we really didn't believe that, we really didn't mean that, now we're going to start sending the taxpayer a dollar, a bill, I mean, for dollars. I got a problem if we're going to start developing that policy. I don't believe that's where we should be going, and I certainly wouldn't support it, that type of a policy.
Okay. Anybody else? Chuck.
I guess in holding with tradition, Ken and I will disagree.
I would expect no less.
I guess first I want to thank you two gentlemen and the committee and the people that have spent their own money to travel over there. I guess I don't know how you can put a dollar on building friendships with our countries and bringing people back and forth, showing them our lifestyle and we learning theirs. If you were going to go between the politicians, nothing would ever get done. There'd be so much red tape, you wouldn't know what was going on. And I think these people have broken that barrier, and you're right down at the ground level working with people that actually understand and try to communicate and work with you. So I think you can put a dollar figure on that. So thanks again for your work.
Anybody, Roy?
Yes, this resolution was discussed quite vividly at our ad hoc committee meeting, and we were going to stop at line number 33. And if we'd have stopped at line number 33, it was felt that we have to be honest with everybody. Anything you do, there is a cost. And we put a figure in it. We could have put a figure of $1,000, $2,000, and we put a figure of $5,000. And it was then further discussed at the admin meeting, well, let's change that to up to. So we're trying to be honest with this resolution. Anything we do is a cost, and that's why we put that figure in there, and that's what it was approved before at the admin meeting.
Okay, anybody else? Leo?
We could wait for Donald Trump to take care of all this stuff. Anyway, the $5,000... came about on my motion, I believe, to go up to that amount. I want everyone to know that it wasn't only the County of Door who participated in the, they had an awful lot of time they spent at Ministry Door County Hospital, and I believe that was beneficial on both ends. Mm-hmm. And when you have one of your larger employers, stepping forward, I think it behooves us to be pro and to join them in their venture. I definitely support it. And John, who is all on that board in 2004? Anybody remaining? Or?
Well, they did say no fiscal impact. If you want to pass resolutions and then not follow them, that's up to you.
Okay. The fact is that we probably, just to counter John, we did probably pass that over that bridge when we put it in the budget the last couple of years. So this is not a, and that was 11 years ago. So we have gone to the budgets after that and put money in for this, so.
Mr. Chairman, I just don't want this to keep coming up every time over and over and over that now we got something started. Right. Well, China did it. Now we can do it. Now we can do it. Now we can do it. I don't want to go down that path, Mr. Chairman. Right.
Biz.
Yeah, when this was done in 2004, in our wildest dreams, we never knew that our sister city was going to provide space in their courtyard or whatever, recognizing Door County. And Greg Meisner did all the design of that, and that was just all donated. You know, he didn't charge the county, he didn't charge the Chinese people, the city. And if we're going to continue a relationship of a sister city, frankly, it would be very, very embarrassing to have a delegation come over from China and say, well, you people are all on your own, stay wherever you want, and you know, at your cost. So down the road, maybe there will be some fundraising, and then it won't be the tax dollars. But, you know, this is a request for this year, and I think Bill illustrated that we may come back next year for the 17 budget and ask for some money, too. It depends what happens. But I volunteered my time to be on the board along with Susan and Roy and Ben Meyer was there too. I don't know how many meetings he made because of his teaching, but the three of us were at most of the meetings on our own time. And I think to continue the relationship that we should have that, what Leo put in there is up to the $5,000 to cover some of their expense when they're here. So I'm going to support the resolution.
Anybody else? Don City.
Yes, I'm curious to know, and this question is for Grant. So we have 19 members present. Does the resolution pass on 10 or 11?
10.
Thank you.
Anybody else? If not, we'll go to the voter board and vote this up or down. Thank you, Bill. Bill.
Thanks.
Does it pass on a 16 yes, 3 no, and 2 vacant? Next item is the Planning Department fees. Ken, would you like to make a motion and get it on the floor and then discuss it?
Well...
Wherever you are.
Actually, no. Wait a minute.
You want to make a motion, put it on the floor, though, Ken?
Okay, I'll make a motion to put it on the floor.
I'll second it.
It's seconded by Don City. Okay, you want to bring someone else?
If I could.
I sure hope you can.
I need to ask a question.
Put it on the floor.
That's the problem.
Is that a correct motion? Just you want to bring it on the floor?
I mean, you can bring it forward, but it's really not proper. Or do you want to put it on the floor and we can all walk on it, or do you want to adopt it?
Yeah, she just chastised me for using that term.
Yeah.
Bring it before the board. How's that sound?
Well, we only do what the chairman tells us.
The motion is made to approve it, right, Ken? That's what you said.
Yes, it is.
Yeah, I thought Kenny said that.
Because that was a good motion.
So we're looking at packet, or page 14 and 15 of your packet. And there's a few things on the fee schedule. One is a permit revision fee, pretty minor. The second major chunk in the middle, the Resource Planning Committee wishes to discourage repeat violators, and so that is what that tiered schedule is about. The committee spoke with our department and Grant several times before they came to that. The next major chunk is related to changes in the state budget. Within the state budget, there were changes to the shoreline zoning program, so we are reacting, as we now need to authorize additional impervious surfaces on many shoreline lots. This will now require stormwater runoff control systems. So these fees are to, oh, and I have Bill Schuster here as well. These fees are to establish a fee for that review and permit process, which we previously did not need before the budget. The last one, number four, to the bottom of the page, is basically changing the name that's given to the wind energy system to be consistent with the state language. So that's the summary of the zoning fee schedule changes.
Has anybody got any questions? Leo?
If I'm going to resurface my deck, what kind of permit fee do I need to pay?
It really depends on where your property is located, obviously. Is it in the floodplain? Is it interior? And the fees, the typical zoning fees are based on the square
footage. I'm redoing what was there before. I'm just mainly putting down a new surface.
Sure. So
I'm not changing anything.
If you look at the top of the
permit fees, 20 years ago.
Sure. If you look at the top of the page, the fee schedule for a regular zoning permit is based on the square footage, so we are not even looking to change any of that. That's been in place for some time.
So that could go up to as high as $500?
If you have a 5,000 square foot deck, I don't know that that's realistic.
Well, I don't know by the time I get done.
I can't imagine what the house is.
Okay. Is there any other questions?
It's just staining your deck.
No. John, Joel.
Putting down the
well, just can you elaborate on this shoreline mitigation and these ones on the bottom that are $1,000? What specifically does that mean, and how does that affect a Joe Blow taxpayer as far as the process in that?
Sure. The shoreline mitigation permit we have established and has been in our ordinance since 2014. It was a requirement of the state regulations that we put that in place. The items in red are to include the need for stormwater runoff per the budget, which requires additional staff time and review. The planning department is not educated or trained in stormwater runoff control processes, so we ask for the Door County Soil and Water Department to help with that review process. Impervious surface authorization is also in response to the requirement from the state budget that we have that in place so that property owners in the shoreline area only within 300 feet of the ordinary high water mark can increase the hard surfaces on their lot.
Was this unanimously approved by the Resource Planning Committee?
Correct. Okay.
Joel?
I just want to further the comment, and this is, I guess, to the committee then. if there's a permit that's required as set by the state, and if I'm building a house or doing something, I have to apply for this, it goes to the Soil and Water or the Planning Department for review. That, to have that those steps done is going to cost $1,000?
If it is required. Not every application will require this. It's only when you hit a certain threshold or percentage of hard surfaces. Again, this is a state-mandated program with no funding from the state. The Shoreland program has been in existence since 68, but these changes are now effective immediately because of the budget.
Joe, if I could, this Bill Schuster, if I could jump in a little bit. So previously, the Door County allowed up to 30% impervious.
I understand all that.
The state pushed it down to 15% impervious. So people can go from 15 to 30% and do the mitigation she talked about, or they could elect to have a stormwater plan. But the area where it's the biggest change from the past is the budget bill allows them to have 100% impervious over the 30. An option, and so now only if someone elects to go over 30%, the budget bill says if they have a stormwater plan for each square foot over the 30%, that impervious area is considered pervious. So it's the budget bill. So it'd be the election of the individual to go over 30% that would kick that in. So your typical project that stays within the limits doesn't need that stormwater plan. It's sure. Only the person who says it's over. So then, and they've done calculations where we're going to have potentially a lot of these. So we sat down with planning and said, you really have three options. County Board had three options. One is, and understand that our department has most of our money is restricted funds. You are on the committee. We can't just use it for different things. So the County Board had three choices. Increase the budget with new tax levy money, provide staff and to do reviews. That wasn't going to happen. Two, we could set up an independent contractor agreement with a review firm and do time and material costs charged back to the applicant. Or three, have as a self-sustaining program, person wants to go over 30%, they have to pay for the staff plan review. I don't know if that helps at all.
No,
not everybody has to do it. It's their decision when they go over in there.
That's ultimately what I was getting at, is this fee is associated with requiring the time of the county staff for review. That's it.
SWC staffing, the $500.
That's it. Not the mere fact that taxpayers are already paying for the operation of the department. This is above and beyond that.
Right. It's self-sustaining program, elected by
that the that I have a problem with, but that's just me.
But I, you know, the other option is new tax levy money, or farm it out to some other review firm,
because
I bet you they'll do more than $500.
Because the potential for greater workload is now there because of this requirement.
We're pretty sure it's.
I understand it is.
Yeah, when they looked at past records, you know, it's hard. It could be a lot. But I can't take wildlife crop damage money or reclamation money or invasive species money or egg money and find it into that. Can't.
Any other questions? Go ahead, David.
More of a comment. We can thank our legislatures for deciding to add something to the budget that should not have been there. It's inappropriate and it costs the homeowners and more expense.
Okay. Anybody else? If not, go to your voter board and vote yes or no.
Yes, sir, we don't vote.
Item before us.
We should. Thank
you. What do I call this motion? That has passed 16 yes, 3 no, and 2 vacant.
Mr. Chairman?
Yes.
As long as Sue is here, I would like to request we go to ordinances for the report and
Terry Jr. Okay, we can do that. You want to make a motion to?
I'll make a motion to accept the report.
Okay. What are we talking about? We're down on ordinances report.
Yeah, page 19.
Who's going to explain that?
Well.
Is there a second?
Second.
Okay. Second by David.
This is to, and Sue is here. That's why I wanted you to go to this. She can explain it better than I can, but it's basically to correct a zoning map error.
Okay. Go ahead, Sue.
Okay, thank you. So this map correction or zoning petition is in the town of Liberty Grove. When reviewing some maps, we found out there was an error on our zoning maps located between the Village of Ephraim and the Village of Sister Bay along Highway State 42. And I'm on page 19, going all the way to page 23. Looking back through all the records of all the conversations with property owners, permits that were issued, Mariah had taken three possible ways to correct the map to the town, and the town and the planning department both recommended what you see on page 23, which is to clear up that zoning line between the mixed-use commercial and the Heartland 3.5 zoning district. So we did hold a public hearing with regard to that, and the committee is proposing that we rezone this so that we can correct the error that had existed for some time.
Okay, has anybody got any questions on the report? All in favor of accepting, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Now, would you like to make a motion, Ken, to...
Now I'll make a motion to approve the zoning, a mandatory zoning ordinance 2015-07.
Second.
Second, but you got that? Is there any questions? If not, we'll go to the voter board for that. Hold on. Good. Okay, go to the voter board. Don City. There. That passed 19 yes, two vacant. Okay, now back up to the transfer of non-budgeted funds. Okay, we okay?
Yep.
We're gonna go back up to the transfer of funds for the voting system. David, you wanna explain that since it went through the finance committee? Make a motion and...
I'll start.
We want to make a motion.
Make a motion that we approve resolution 2015-71.
I'll second that, Mr. Chairman.
Okay, go ahead.
This came before the clerk of courts, the county clerk.
No, county clerk.
County clerk. Has been evaluating over the last several years new voting machines as required. And it wasn't until this year that it was approved by the state. This particular machine. So the county clerk has in the past worked with the various municipalities in the county to determine how they would be funded when they came up for purchase. At the time, there was an agreement with most of the municipalities to provide 50% of the funding and the county provide the balance. When it came up for presentation to the admin committee and subsequently to the finance committee, the admin committee recommended that the county pay 100% of the basic machine costs. There are other costs besides the machine, which we'll get into. And they're roughly $8,200, $8,500 each, is my understanding. At the admin committee, it was discussed and recommended that the county pay 100% of the cost of the basic machine, and that was forwarded to the finance committee. It was discussed at the finance committee, and the finance committee agreed with the administrative committee's recommendation that it be funded at 100%. And the finance committee subsequently recommended that the balance of, I believe, was $120,000 necessary to purchase the equipment would come out of the unassigned fund balance.
Is there any questions? We should maybe ask Jill to make a comment.
The only comment that I would like to make, and Grant suggested, after finance committee, admin committee and finance committee reviewed, I did check with Grant. We do need to have an intergovernmental agreement in place. So going forward, although the cost of the equipment would be covered by the county, the actual maintenance and software licensing and warranty licensing or costs would still be maintained by the municipality, which is currently what they do. The equipment that they have now, they currently fund their upkeep or maintenance on it and licensing on the both pieces of equipment. So it's really not a change, but it's something that we would like to see put in place it doesn't hinge or, you know, change anything with this particular resolution or the request, but just as an FYI, so that you all know going forward, that would be a cost that they would continue to absorb, the municipalities.
Does anybody got any questions?
I had a question of Jill. Is the cost more?
More than what?
To maintain?
It could be slightly more. It's not a tremendous amount more, but off the top of my head, I don't know how much more.
The reason I ask is that, you know, this time of year, we're all making up budgets as well. And are you going to notify the townships and municipalities that there might be an increase in the cost or what?
Well, right. Depending on the outcome of today, they right. have not been notified of anything because at this point, they thought they were under a 50-50 cost share, so which they were all in agreement to. They... Well, let's wait and see how the outcome is today, yeah. And of course, then we would need to know. I would notify them.
Thank you.
Would you like me to comment on that, 50-50, Mr.
Well, Susan had her hand up first. I'm not going to go down that road.
Okay.
I just thought maybe Jill would comment on what David referenced, that there might be other costs the municipalities would have if they, and what those pieces of equipment and things might be.
Sure. So what we discussed, or what the Admin and Finance Committee discussed and ultimately came to decide upon, when we talk about the paying for equipment, that is just what it is, just the equipment portion of it. So it is your tabulator and your ballot box. That's the equipment that Supervisor Leno referred to as approximately $8,500. Beyond that, they have the option of purchasing a carrying case, extra supplies, things of that nature, that the county would not be covering as far as the costs related to that particular part of it. If they choose to have some of those extras, then the municipality would buy that themselves, which technically now, granted this is a new machine, so our supplies aren't moving to the new machine, but they do that already. The municipalities cover their own costs as far as supplies already. I don't foresee that the municipalities need a carrying case. The new voting system is approximately 50 pounds, and it can stay together as one unit as long as you have a storage place. So although we have a handful of municipalities that, you know, may need to transport it, it is a very few, maybe two or three, and ultimately hoping maybe they could work out a area with their wherever they vote, their polling place, to perhaps leave it there. So a carrying case isn't necessary, and it is about $200 going forward. So things like that, we would not, the county as a whole would not cover.
David,
is there also any additional expense for a visually impaired person, or is there anything additional that has to be added to the basic machine?
The municipality has the option to add a separate monitor to the basic machine, which has a 15-foot cord and could be ran to the side or back of the machine with a separate voting booth for the visually impaired. The machine itself has that on it. As we discussed, it does, if somebody would be required or has need, it needed, not required, but is a need that they have to use that part of the machine. It does hold up voting for the rest of the people, although there is an auxiliary slot where those ballots would go, and after the person was done voting, the poll workers could then take those ballots and put them through the machine. So they do have the option of buying an extra monitor and putting that off to the side. That would again be a cost that the municipality would pick up 100%, because given my research and talking with the clerks, at this particular point in our county, nobody was aware of anybody that needed to have that. So we don't expect the lines to be held up. So the handicap part of the machine, although needed because of federal law, isn't being used here in Door County at this point, but it is there on the whole machine as a whole. It just causes a little bit of a disruption, but nothing that can't still be worked out. And it also could be added at a future date if a municipality was finding that they had more and more voters that needed to use that part of the machine, it can be added at a separate time. But again, the cost of that would be covered by the municipality.
Who owns the old machine, and what do you do with it?
So the original optical scan machine, which was purchased in the late 90s, was paid for 100% by the county and given to the municipality. So technically, the county owns that machine.
Are you going to pick it up then?
Well, we have to discuss that yet. And then the when the Help America Vote Act came through in 06, we were required to put in the machine for visually impaired, and that was through federal grants. So technically, the municipality owns that one. So you could get rid of that yourself, technically.
Randy, do you have a question?
Do you know what the cost is for that extra monitor?
About $1,200.
Joel?
You mentioned something about software and licensing and stuff. If it's a county-owned machine, are they going to be given to the municipalities and again, or are they still going to be county-owned going forward here? Because I'm wondering how a license, a software agreement, if a municipality doesn't own it, how can they pay to license it?
Well, the county will be billed for it, and they will be passing on the cost to the municipality. Currently, technically, they're paying already on their optical scan unit that technically the county owns, but for years they've been direct billed by the company. We would suspect going forward, and that's something we changed in my budget, was to put a line item for receiving one bill as a whole for everybody and then rebilling that, sharing the cost with the municipality.
Is there any cost on what that is? Any ideas? That
as we budgeted $10,000 as a whole.
Per machine or total?
No, as a total for the county.
Biz?
Yeah, Jill, does this machine speed up the process of tallying up the votes faster than what we have?
Well, that
remains to be
seen. Well, I don't know. It depends on how you look at it. So right now, they are required to send to modem through two separate machines, and they will be going to one machine. So technically, yes, it would speed up the end result on the county's end.
Well, then the workers are going to be there less time.
One would hope for that.
So they're going to save money, and you know, I don't see why they can't pay their portion. I'm not going to support this because I don't think the county should foot the bill for the whole thing. The city gets three machines, and other municipalities get, I guess, one, huh? And, you know, they're going to have a little savings there. I just can't see why we foot the bill for the whole thing.
I think you need to look at the city as not having it. They have three polling places also. If a municipality would have had a second polling place, mm-hmm. they would have gotten machines. We're putting a machine in each polling place, not necessarily each municipality. So it's each polling place. If we would have municipalities, you know, who are the size of the city, they would also probably have had more than one polling place. So it's five polling place.
Mark?
The other reason to go ahead with this would be that every machine would be the same then. If you don't do this, the municipalities could choose to go a different route, and you could ball up the whole works completely by having incompatible software and other issues.
Chuck?
I just wanted to thank Biz for his extra contribution for the city.
We agree.
We appreciate it.
I do too.
Well, I don't live there any longer. And Leo says he could find money in his budget for where I do live in Sevastopol.
I was initially against the resolution because of the half of it paid, but when I found out the city gets three machines, I'm the same with Chuck. I changed my mind.
Yeah, that changed your mind.
Sure.
Well, the alternative, Mr. Chairman, is we could let the municipalities pay for the whole thing by themselves.
Sure.
No, that's not going to happen. Anyway.
Now, then don't cry.
I'm not. Is this mandatory?
The vote? Not necessarily.
No.
No, the municipalities could hand count. I think if you.
I was just curious if.
Bring that back to your clerk and suggest that they. Oh,
no. You're probably asking that the machines be upgraded, or does the existing equipment suffice?
The existing equipment has met the end of its useful life.
That's probably your question.
Yeah.
What's the shelf life on this, Jill? What was the guesstimate?
So we've gone about 15 years on our 16, 17 years on our current equipment. we should hope that we get that out of it, but, you know, it's like a, it's a computer. So you guys got your Zooms in 2011, and you're looking at replacement in 16.
I call for the vote.
Any other questions? If not, we'll go to the voter board. He who does the most fucking wants this. That passed on an 18 yes, one no, with two vacant.
Yeah, Biz doesn't get the vote then.
He has to do all the hand counting.
He's going to count them paper-wise. Okay, the next item is the part-time pay rate, resolution 2015-72. Ken, you want to comment on that, or? Wait, let me make a motion. I have to get a motion first. Motion by.
Motion to approve it.
Biz, seconded by Chuck to approve. Okay, go ahead. You got to let him do something.
Sure. Just to take a step back, this actually started before I started on board, but at the last meeting, they did discuss it. And what they were looking at is for the, I guess, seasonal positions within the various departments, is looking at increasing the wage rate. And what you have before you is the recommendation from the administrative committee in terms of the adjustments for the pay. So you'll see the classes broken down for highway, airport, and parks, and also highway, the circuit court, and the museum for 2015-72. Just jumping ahead, just really quick, I'll just comment on 2015-73, that also then is similar in terms of adjusting those rates within those areas. And then in terms of the fiscal impact, you can see the analysis was done by finance. So with these adjustments for the 2015-72, you're looking at impact of approximately $28,000 for this fiscal year.
Does anybody got any questions? Leo?
Mr. Chairman, I would make a motion that we send this back to the admin solely because number 72, we had asked for a highway and airport and park split, and it doesn't show up there. I would send both of them back for further review.
I'll second that, Mr. Chairman.
Okay, the motion is to
send it to admin.
Postpone it, send it back to committee, I guess is the correct words.
Refer it back to the committee.
Refer it back to the committee. Motion by Leo and seconded by Ken to postpone and refer it back to committee. Go ahead, Susan.
I'm just going to restate what I heard sitting and listening to this discussion, which was our department heads, particular highway, asking that this could go forward and that the concept of splitting then could be considered on its own for future, but to not hold this up. That I guess what I was hearing is department heads saying we need this in order to be able to move forward. So that is what they were saying, and it makes some sense.
Susan, but the resolution is not going into effect until January 1st. That's what both resolutions say.
Are they not aware that it? I don't know.
I don't know, but that's what the resolution is, January 1st. So
we'll get it back here.
There's time to get it back. Okay. Go to the back and bring it here. Go ahead.
Well, point of order, we already had a motion on the floor, you know, to approve this. And now Leo's made another motion to send it back.
Right, postpone it. That can supersede the.
That takes precedent
takes
over the
precedent
main motion.
Over the motion on the floor.
If it was seconded, and it
yes,
was.
Yes, it was seconded, but Ken. Yeah.
Thank you. All in favor.
Go ahead, Chuck.
Does this motion mean two resolutions, the part-time fee rates also?
Yes.
Correct.
Yes, correct. You got it. Hang on.
I was going to resend my motion, but I guess I don't have
okay, to. Go to the voter board. Wait a second.
My amendment to refer it back. Is
the motion on the floor is to postpone it and send it back to committee to come back to us.
Both of them?
Both resolutions.
And we're.
Right.
Pardon?
You're talking about both resolutions. Thank you.
We get a vote.
Okay. Go to your voter board and vote yes or no.
Yes. Vote yes. Get it done.
That is passed 17 yes, 2 no, and two vacant. So, the last item on ordinances now is the speed zone in County WD. John, you want to make, you're the chairman of the committee, go ahead.
I'll make a motion for approval.
Okay, is there a second?
I'll second that, Mr. Chairman.
Well, very good. On your desk was a correction or something? A legal correction, or what is it?
Well, I'll let John speak first, and then I'm going to move for an amendment.
Okay, go ahead, John.
Well, this was brought to the Highway Committee by Mr. Zipper, and we sent it on to the Highway Safety Committee, where it was approved with the blessing of the sheriff. And then they sent it back to the Highway Committee, and we approved it again. And now I see this on my desk this morning. Maybe I'd like to have Mr. Kaloji explain what's going on.
Okay. John, you want to come up?
I could introduce the amendment at the same time.
Do you want to introduce the amendment before or after John is done speaking?
Well, let's see what he's got to say. Maybe he'll change my mind.
After the Highway Committee meeting, I researched the Code of Ordinance book and determined that on WD there's a couple of speed zones there that are not consistent with our Code of Ordinances. I talked to Mr. Zipper about it and indicated that if he wanted to introduce an alternative, that it might be best to do that. He was the one who brought the issue forward originally to correct it, to be consistent with what is actually signed in the field to our Code of Ordinances. There's a stretch that's already zoned 35 mile an hour and 25 miles an hour as you get into Whitefish Dunes State Park area as WD traverses through the park. For some reason, that signage was changed years ago. I don't know the history behind it, but I thought this would be an opportune time to present that as an alternate. If not, it would have to, you know, the Highway Committee could take it up at a subsequent meeting.
Okay, this was given to Grant Thomas, who gave his blessings as far as the way to proceed. What this amounts to, I'll make the motion first that the ordinance 2015-08 that you are seeing on your desk with the blue information and in regard to the speed zone on County Trunk Highway WD be approved, then I'll explain it.
Okay, is there a second to that? Second by Don City.
The situation is this. For those unfamiliar with the area, John Paul, who is a resident in our town of Sevastopol, brought it forward to the town board, indicating that there was a little problem with the speed heading easterly going to the park. I brought it to the county highways. They went to the highway safety. John Paul showed up to express his concern, as well as came back to highways again for activity. The situation is, if you're going on Clark Lake or WD, easterly, the first Nelson Lane road to the south, and you go a tad bit more, and there's a Nelson Lane that goes north. From that easterly, you go and you have about four driveway entrances to the left before you come to the bed and breakfast, Whitefish Bay bed and breakfast, on your right-hand side, and that's also where the sheep farm is. Immediately adjacent, right over the top of the hill, is a road going to the left, which is Whitefish Court. So as you do come over the crest of the hill, you really don't know what's ahead of you, but you're allowed to go 55 miles an hour. From that time, you're looking to see what's happening, and the next thing you see is a 35 mile an hour speed limit going into Whitefish Dunes State Park. That's also at the entrance to West Shore Drive to the left. So because there was not any evidence that those speed limits were legal, proper, or whatever, Grant and John came up with the idea that we would handle them all at once. The, as I say, would start at the intersection of Nelson Lane. That would be the road that goes to the north rather than the closest one to the south. And it would go about 7 tenths of a mile towards the park. It would create the following speed zones on the county trunk WD at 45 from Nelson Lane to West Shore Road, 35 from West Shore Road to Dunes Park Road, and 25 mile an hour from Dunes Park to the termini of County Trunk Highway WD, which is also Cape Point. You go that area, you know, is a winding road, and the 25 is proper. It's been marked for a while. When you first get into it and you get on to, let's see, it would be Clark Lake Beach and also Whitefish Bay Creek. You can see it is rather open, but then suddenly it is rather clear that you better slow down. So this would affect that change, and by approving this ordinance as an amendment two, we can do it all at one time. We don't have to send it back in.
Okay. Go ahead, Chuck.
Leo, prior to the hill and the drop right there by the farm, is that included in your slowdown speed, or is that come after that?
Yeah, it'll start at Nelson Lane.
Going to the south?
No, Nelson Lane going north. It's only like 500 feet or so.
Any other questions?
Stop ahead signs of 45 will, that cautionary sign will be up to work.
Do you have any other questions? Roy?
Yes, Mr. Chair. If I heard correctly, we're talking about a 45 mile speed limit for a 6 tenths of a mile. Is that what I heard?
No, the entire area is 6 tenths of a mile. And it would, I believe you are correct. It would be 45 until you got to the park and then reduced to 35.
Why wouldn't we have 35 miles right from Nelson Road? That's my question. Why only going to 45?
Well, I think with the discussion with the sheriff and with John, we thought if we put some 35 sign up there that's not going to be obeyed, then we shouldn't put any sign up there. So we're trying to get them slowed down. If you leave Highway 57 and go easterly, it's an open speed limit at 55. Mm-hmm. We don't have a 55 mile an hour sign there. That's just assumed you can go that fast. So after you get over the crest of the hill, we want you to be slowed down. So then when you do get to 35, you can actually be doing 35.
Chuck?
Yeah, I think also, isn't there something that you have to have so many driveways or residences to drop it more than 10 miles an hour along the county highway?
Or town or anything. That
John is saying yes. So you
John's saying yes.
Yeah, so you actually couldn't reduce it more than 10 miles.
Right. That's spoken as a former sheriff. You are right.
Any other questions? If not, I'll have Kenny talk to you.
I'm sorry. I know I was at the meeting. did we authorize this? I thought yes. We were going to look into it yet.
No, you authorized it. Not the amended it, but the first one.
Here was the crux of the deal. The sheriff had recommended through his lieutenant that we put the speed board out there first to see what kind of speed was coming along. And after discussion with him and the delay, it was going to be, the snow was going to be falling, and we're not even going to get close to slowing down the traffic now when we do it. The problem is that we get an awful lot of people at Cape Point Park, and we got a real parking problem over there that the Airport and Parks Committee will take care of.
We're working on that.
But this would be a prelude to it. And also the sheriff has agreed that once the signs are up, he will put the speed board out there to see how many are in compliance. If we have a problem, we have to have enforcement or else we take down the signs. Very simple.
Any other questions? Dick Haynes. Am I hearing this right? We're going to have three signs in like 0.6 mile?
No, it's all 45 in that area.
45, 35, and 25?
Mm-hmm. That's all. In the first 0.6 mile, it'll be 45. Okay. Once you get into the park, which is already marked now.
Okay, all right, okay.
We're just establishing it as a zone.
So there's not going to be three signs in 0.6 mile?
No.
No, oh, okay.
Unless you're not obeying it, then we'll put up more signs.
I was going to say that. Any other questions? If not, go to the voter board and vote up Leo's amendment to the ordinance, which is explained and has been explained. So this is the amendment. Any motion? That is passed on 19 yes, 2 vacant.
Thank you.
So then now we'll have a vote on amended ordinance. Has anybody got any questions on it? If not, we'll go to the voter board. Ready? For the overall ordinance. Should pass the same, I would think.
No.
You never know. That is passed 19 yes, 2 vacant. Is there any oral committee reports?
For the update before I
go ahead, Susan.
I just wanted to announce that the legislative committee normally meets the second Wednesday. We are moving our meeting for this month till the second Monday in order to be able to schedule meetings with our legislators. Representative Kitchens has confirmed with me that he will join us. And I have a tentative commitment from Senator Lissay. I still need to hear back that that's finalized. And the time of it is either 1 or 2. That's a little bit up in the air depending on what I hear from the staffer. But if you're interested in attending, it's the 14th of September.
Okay. Any other oral committee reports? Is there any questions on any of the minutes? Biz?
No, well, I was just going to bring up that I'm asking people that are on the Airport and Parks Committee to look at your Zoom and do your voting on upcoming meetings. And then I think Jill had an email out that we were notified that the property meeting on the 2nd is not going to work, but we're going to pick a new date when we meet on Thursday.
Okay.
Thank you.
Is there any other committee minutes? Any questions on the vouchers, claims, and bills? If not,
motion to adjourn.
Second.
What?
The two military.
Yeah, I didn't. We're not there yet. Calm down. The next county board meeting is September 29th at 9:00. Remind everybody that we have 2 vacancies on the county board. We only have 1 person apply so far, and that would be in Ben Myers' district. So there's nobody. I don't know, David, what is that? Gibraltar, I guess, is the main part of that. That where yes, Holly's from in the Gibraltar area. Mm-hmm.
My understanding was that somebody has sent you a letter for that.
I haven't seen it yet. And I'd like to remind everybody, if you're not doing nothing on Thursday morning at 8:30, to come to the property committee as a guest, not get paid. Because I think there's going to be some interesting discussion.
And I'm not going.
Now we can have the motion to adjourn.
Second.
Motion by Don City. Okay. Before I take a vote, she's got one announcement.
Information for those attending WCA in a few weeks was on your desk in an envelope. And if you ordered a shirt, they are in my office, so please stop and pick them up.
Okay. In favor of adjourning, I'll say aye.
Aye.
Opposed.
Extra large.
Ooh, we got to drive.